Hi, this is Jeff Heaton. Welcome to Applications of Deep Neural Networks with Washington University. In this video, we're going to look at how to use apply and map functions together with pandas. This allows you to write lambda functions or other functions that will be executed across your entire data frame. This allows you to do relatively complicated transformations to your data frame that might be very useful for feature engineering, which allows you to represent the data in ways that will allow your neural network to be more predictive.
For the latest on my AI course and projects, click subscribe and the bell next to it to be notified of every new video.
Apply and map are two functions that are provided by a pandas data frame that you can use directly on these. Now we've seen map already for just general Python data structures, lists in particular. But map can be used with data frames to do similar types of transformations. For more advanced feature engineering that you'll probably have to do with some of the projects in this class, apply and map can be very, very useful. And we'll look at a specific case in the later part about how to do just that. So let's go ahead and load in the AutoMPG data set. We are going to do a very simple mapping on it. This is one of the most common things that you will do for maps. This is similar to a decode in SQL. What we're going to do is this origin value that you have here specifies the region that the car was from. One is North America, two is Europe, and three is Asia. So what we're going to do for this is we're going to take the origin. We're going to create a column called origin name, and we're going to fill it in all cases where this is what the map will do. It's going to look up the origin value, and it's going to replace it with North America for one, Europe for two, and Asia for three. So let's run that. And if I scroll that over a little bit, you can see North America, Asia for that three, Asia, Europe is two. And so on. So this can be a very good way to summarize values. You could actually, say you had numbers in here that were all the 50 states of the United States of America. You could put a bunch of values in here that go to the same thing. You could do one to North America, two to North America, or even state names. Missouri to North America, California to North America, New York to North America, and so on and so forth. Whereas if you saw France, it would go to Europe. So you could also use this to summarize. Apply is another thing that you can use with these data sets. Apply basically takes a function, typically a lambda, and runs it against every single row in the data set. So here, let's go ahead and run this. This is calculating something that I call an efficiency. It's basically the displacement divided by the horsepower. So how big is your engine versus how much horsepower do you actually get? And this gives you a general indication of the efficiency of the car. So we could add that in to the data set. This shows how you're sort of engineering a feature based on this ratio. Here I'll show you a more complex example of feature engineering. This was actually an assignment in previous semesters. You'll probably see an assignment about like this one in this semester. This basically is using a data set that we have here from the IRS, which is a United States government taxing authority. And we're going to, there's also more data documentation on here if you care to read about it. But this is basically a data set that gives you the estimated adjusted gross income plus other things for zip codes in the United States. So the fields that you care about are state, which is the state, example, Missouri, zip code, is the zip code of within that state. AGI stub are six different income brackets. So one is the lowest income, six is the highest income. Each zip code is going to have six rows for it then. They give you a count, which is N1, of the number of people in each of those income brackets. So that gives you sort of a distribution of wealth in that particular zip code. What we're going to try to do is put those bands back together so that you have a estimate of what the overall AGI is for that particular zip code. So this is a reduction. You've got six rows for each zip code. You want to crunch that down to just one row per zip code and just give an overall estimate of the adjusted grossed income. And this is kind of what the file looks like. See, you've got 63017. It's a zip code that I work in. AGI stub. So that's your six values they have for each. And then the count. So the second to the highest is the largest income. This shows this particular income. If you do probably the most famous zip code in the United States of America, 90210, it'd probably be pretty high because it's a very affluent zip code. So you see a lot of numbers down here. What we're going to do to put it back together, this is the bands for each of these. One is 1 to 25K, six is 200,000 or more. Now, one of the issues with putting this back together is 200,000 or more, that's a pretty big category. That could be up to, I don't know, probably many millions of dollars, however much those guys are making. So what we're going to do is we're going to establish a median for each of these ranges, 12,500. Now this last one, since we don't know what the ceiling is, 212,500, that's probably the biggest flaw in this estimate that I'm putting together, but you can see about where those are at. So the way that we can estimate 63017's average AGI is we're going to basically sum all those N1s, so that's our total count. We're going to add those all up. We're going to total up the AGIs, but weighting them by the medians. So we're going to take the count of people that, so the 4710 times 12,500, because that's how many people were in band one, that's the median for band one. Band two, there were 2,780, and 37,500 was the median for that one. So we're essentially, this is sort of a weighted sum that you have here. And then we're going to divide those. And that gives us the average income for this zip code is around 88,000, which seems reasonably correct. This is good too because this gives us a value that we can check by hand. Because we calculated this by hand, so our automated process that's going to calculate for every single zip code should come up with the same value. So we're going to load that data set into RAM. If it was big and gigantic, you'd probably want to stream it, but this is loading the entire data frame. It'll be loaded in a second. That might have took a while. That took probably 20 seconds for me. Now what we're going to do, so this is going to show you a good example of using multiple of these techniques together. Now this data set does have some junk data in it. So we have zip codes that are 0 and 9999. There's no such zip codes. They do have a purpose in the data file, but we're simply not using them. So we are going to get all the rows, that's what loc does for us, where the data frame is not equal to 0 zip code and the zip code is not equal to 9999. And we're also going to only pull back these fields. So we're chopping this thing down horizontally and vertically. We're getting rid of a bunch of columns and all the rows that have these invalid zip codes. You run that. This is actually very quick. And now the data frame has been modified. If you were to display the data frame, you'll see that it has literally just these four. And the invalid ones are also gone, but we're not going to go hunting for them. What we're now going to do is we're going to take all of these AGI stubs and replace those with the medians. Those medians that I gave you, 1 through 6. So this is a brilliant application of the map. We run that. Again, it's very, very quick. And if we look at this, we now see that those should have transformed, and they have. The AGI stubs are now those actual income medians. Next, we group it by zip code. And for each of those zip codes now, we can basically perform a lambda. So this is a great use for apply. We're going to do apply across it, and we're going to basically sum because we want to sum up all of the values in each of those zip codes, but we're going to sum them weighted. So we're going to basically weight the N1, so how many of them we have, say the 30 there, multiplied by the AGI stub. And then we're dividing the whole thing by N1, which is the sum of the N1s, actually. You can see the sum there for that entire zip code. Then we reset the index so that the row numbers align, like we've seen before. We run that. That does take just a few seconds. Let's see what that actually did. We now pretty much have the data set where we want it to be. Zip code, and this is the average for each of those. The column headers are a little bit sloppy. Zip code, that's good, but zero, what's the zero? Zero should be our average AGI, our AGI estimate. We'll just rename those two columns, and then we display the top. And we can see now we've got this nice output. You'd probably want to 2CSV that, and that would be a completely valid submission for that previous assignment that I ran in last semester. We'll look up our zip code that we calculated by hand, and that matches our 88689 that we had before. Thank you for watching this video. In the next video, we're going to continue with using pandas and talk about feature engineering, which is how you represent your data set in a way that helps the neural network to be more predictive. This content changes often, so subscribe to the channel to stay up to date on this course and other topics in artificial intelligence.